Welcome, everyone. My name is Dana White. Welcome to the Myth Salon. Today, we have Dr. John Beebe with us. And curiously, in talking about culture and cultural attitudes, we are often talking about clusters, or we're talking about one attitude set apart from another attitude. And the problems that we run into are often problems of separation. They are attitudes that run into conflict with one another. And so we're seeing that today, writ large, as we have for the past couple of years, through the pandemic. And once again, this pandemic is wreaking havoc upon our travel patterns, upon our tendencies to gather, our desires to go out to restaurants, public transportation. So while the pandemic is around, I'd still like to open the Myth Salon, as I do, with a moment of silence for those among us that we might have lost or who are having difficulty because of the pandemic. I recently became aware of a group of a particular man in Berkeley named John Powell. And I was struck by his grace and humility. I was struck by his history. The nature of what he is about is what he calls othering and belonging. I've turned othering into a verb following the spirit of Hillman. And we have a poem here that I'll call Othering. I am most true to myself when I transcend selectivity, when I can accept all differences as virtues speaking to me. When otherness and the spirits of belonging are infinite, when my skills at othering are boundless, the uniqueness of everything flows through my hand like water, nourishing, unsullied by recognition, without language, walls, borders, or fences. I am most true to myself when trust and love are universal, when my skills at othering make me curious, not fearful, cautious, or apprehensive. I am most true to myself when I am seen and listen, when I become the other to whatever it is I think I am, and discover myself for the first time. Simply put, I am because you are. So tonight, I'd like to turn this over to my good friend and colleague, Will Linn, to introduce the panel and especially give a heartfelt welcome to John Beebe, Dyane Sherwood, Francis, Carol Pearson, my dog, who's just coming back from the walk, Vorris, and Dennis. So, let's play together for a while. Let's belong. Let's meet one another. Thank you.
Thank you, Dana. I've really been looking forward tonight since we talked about this event last. I think we've all got a sense that we're in the middle of some kind of emerging. And I think we're all looking for some kind of guidance on what it is. And when it comes to understanding what it is we're going through, what's going on, and what emergence we might be experiencing and how we might be able to participate in that, I think that's actually one of the hottest things on on most of our minds, burning in many of our hearts. So I'm really looking forward to this evening. My name is Will Linn. I'm the founder of Myth House in the General Education Department at Hushman College and LA Center Studios, where I teach myth, story, and philosophy to filmmakers and performing artists. In the last few years, I've appeared in a couple dozen documentaries and TV episodes as a mythologist. Dana has launched this Myth Salon in 2016 as a PhD mythologist looking for some community. He serves on the faculty of Pacifica's Myth Program. He edits, designs, and produces books on myth and depth psychology under the Copper Cauldron Publishing imprint. So that's the two of us, and it is our pleasure to get to introduce everybody. There's a lot on this panel. There's a ton of metal tonight, a lot of long titles that deserve a lot of respect and patience going through. So I hope you'll join me in welcoming Dr. Dennis Patrick Slattery as well, who's a distinguished emeritus professor in the Mythological Studies program at Pacific Graduate Institute. He is the author, co-author, editor, or co-editor of 30 volumes, including seven volumes of poetry and one novel. His latest collection of essays is The Way of Myth, Stories, Subtle Wisdom. His paintings, pottery, blogs, and book titles, as well as upcoming events, can be found at DennisPatrickSlattery.com, which we'll share in the chats. Vorris Nunley is a professor at the University of California, Riverside, who teaches rhetoric, philosophy, and literature through the lens of depth psychology. He is interested in issues of Gnosticism and heretical energy, the dark feminine, racial and gender knowledges, the rhizome, and commodification of consciousness. His most recent presentation was a Sophia Center seminar on the monstrous women and meta-narrative, where he addressed the Adam and Eve myth in contemporary culture. Thanks for being back with us again tonight, Dyane. Dyane Sherwood collaborated with the late Joseph L. Henderson, MD, on a book relating to the images of the splendor solus to the process of transformation and analysis. Dr. Henderson had his personal analysis with C.G. Jung and was the only American contributor to Jung's remarkable book, Man and His Symbols. Dr. Sherwood is a Jungian psychoanalyst, sand play therapist, and author. She founded the Analytical Psychology Press, and I hope you'll go back and check out her last couple myth salons with us. Carol Pearson, thanks for being with us again as well. Carol's work is centered around the application of archetypal psychology to personal and organizational development, leadership, and branding. She served as professor of leadership studies in the School of Public Policy at the University of Maryland, director of the James McGregor Burns Academy of Leadership, and executive vice president, provost, and president of Pacifica Graduate Institute. You can learn more about her 12 archetype model in one of her many books, from Hero Within to The Power of Archetypes, What Stories Are You Living, and Persephone Rising. Francis Liu, MD. Francis Liu is the Luke and Grace Kim Endowed Professor in Cultural Psychiatry. Thanks for being with us tonight for the first time. Dr. Liu is the Director of Cultural Psychiatry and Associate Chair for Medical Student Education at the UC Davis Health System, recipient of APA awards and commendations for his work on cross-cultural psychiatry and the integration of Asian issues into the field. Dr. Liu is focused on cultural competence and diversity, mental health disparities, and psychiatric education with an emphasis on the interface of psychiatry and religion or spirituality, especially through film, which is awesome for our audience. And I think many of you know, many of our audience members out there are filmmakers. So thanks for joining us tonight. And now I get to welcome John Beebe. Dr. John Beebe is a past president of the C.G. Jung Institute of San Francisco, where he studied with Joseph Henderson and other analysts who had known Jung after completing his degrees at Harvard and the University of Chicago. His books include Integrity and Depth and Energies and Patterns and Psychological Type, The Reservoir of Consciousness. Thank you, John, for joining us tonight. Looking forward to this evening.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Let me say something that is just for today at this time and this place. Let me describe a very odd kind of oniric, that is, dream event that took place in my own nightly sleep about 7 or 8 days before I first heard the word Omicron. And so that will give you a sense of when. I had one of those dreams that probably inspired the famous song, Darn That Dream, because it seemed to go on all night. And I kept having the same dream over and over again. And no matter how I tossed and turned in my sleep and said, I get it. The dream kept on being the same dream. This was a dream that had no imagery. It had no sound. It had no voice. it was a thought, and a thought that consisted of exactly five words. And no matter how many times my brain registered those five words, whoever it is or whatever it is that drives dreams was not convinced that I had gotten it, because it gave them back to me again and again and again until I think it was satisfied that I'd truly gotten it through my thick head. I think the only way I can possibly interpret the kind of night I had with this dream. The five words were, these are not normal times. I'm so grateful for that dream. I am really grateful for that dream. I doubt I could have gotten through the last month without it. It's really been incredibly helpful as I try to see people through this. So that may or may not relate to what I'm talking about, but to leave it out would be a terrible mistake, because this talk is coming at a particular time. Now, when I was hearing Dana talk about what he got from John Powell about othering, I immediately thought of something I could not find directly in C.G. Jung in his wonderful work on complexes, but rather got from a very different kind of person that was doing much the same kind of work as Jung, someone else who also pioneered the psychotherapy of with schizophrenic patients specifically, which was where Jung started to make himself famous. And this was Harry Stack Sullivan, a really great American psychiatrist who should not be forgotten. And from Sullivan, I learned something about complexes that I did not learn from C.G. Jung that has been very helpful to me. Sullivan was, like his last name, extremely Irish-American, but very Irish. And so he had this very unusual vocabulary that he used for just about everything. But so when he talked about complexes, he didn't say complexes, as most people even were saying in psychiatry and everywhere else because of Jung's work, but he used the term parataxic distortions. And so the word parataxic deserves a trip to the dictionary. Parataxic is characterized by or relating to a mode of individual experience in which persons, events, and relationships are perceived as discrete phenomena in which occurrences in the real world are seen as having no sequential or logical relationship, but in which all external stimuli have only idiosyncratic autistic significance. So if you add that parataxic to distortion, I think you get a very good idea of what a complex does to the human mind and also, frankly, the human heart. Because as Sullivan said, and this is echoing something Dana said that made me think of Sullivan, so I'm closing the loop here. Sullivan said that you know you're in the grip of a parataxic distortion, and I'm going to be Jungian on him and say when you're in the grip of a complex, you know you're in the grip of the complex because, and these are Sullivan's words, your mind displays selective inattention. In other words, you selectively don't attend to anything but what belongs to the complex. So the complex makes you see, with its parataxic distortion, only that which you think relates to your point of view already. So it's a little bit like the situation where someone with a set of opinions listens to the same radio station and constantly gets the parataxic distortion of that radio station. I doubt that has happened to anyone here. So when you're in a complex, it's precisely then that you're not attending. That is, by the way, why the I Ching is so helpful, because if you know you're in a complex and you know you're not really thinking as you should, and you consult the I Ching, although you're using a magical method of divination, nevertheless, by making a series of coin tosses or counting of euro stocks, your question, and accessing a chapter in the I Ching, you get a much broader objective perception of that, and it moves you out of that selective inattention and makes you pay attention to all the things you aren't attending to. And it has a very calming and healing effect, as you probably know, who have used the I Ching, and I've used it a lot for just that purpose, and learned the difference in that way between being in a complex and being objective about the situation one is in. So obviously our dreams try to help us, our therapists try to help us. People imagine sometimes synchronicities help us. I think synchronicities more often come when we've actually moved somewhat out of the complex and are beginning to be welcoming the whole picture, and the synchronicity is a kind of yes, welcome, and then it underlines what we need to add in and are beginning to realize we need. So obviously we partly want myth to help us also in those ways, because we want myths to take us beyond our personal issues. But I've noticed that people have a way of interpreting mythology through their own complexes. So it's amazing to listen to interpretations of myths and how many parataxic distortions can take place. An example that I used to use is in a wonderful book in many other ways by Edward Edinger called Ego and Archetype, where he talks about the story of Icarus and Daedalus. And he talks about how Daedalus made the wax wings for Icarus, but advised him not to fly too high. And Icarus ignored the advice, and that led Dr. Edinger to intone in his volume on all the young people who don't listen to the advice of their fathers and fly too high. And so we had a kind of standard Jungian depreciation of the poor Eternus. And it seemed to me that you can't read Greek mythology without realizing what a trickster Daedalus is. And so any father that wants the child to fly too high is going to tell his son not to fly too high. Isn't that so? And it seems to me that reading this myth through the archetype of the trickster rather than through the archetype of the commandment not to do this and not to do that, it seems to me to miss some of the humor, the wit, and the subtle value of myth. It reminds me of something that the great literary critic Edmund Wilson said about reading the book of Genesis. He pleases him most about Genesis is what a funny book it is, what a wonderfully funny book it is. Perhaps one of the funniest lines in the Bible is in one of the worst moments in the Bible, when God says to Cain, "What have you done with Abel?" And of course, God knows perfectly well what he's done with Abel. So what does that question mean? And that type of feeling for irony has always come rather naturally to me. And I realized that belongs to something that has taken me beyond the seriousness and the tunnel vision of my own complexes. And I've had to ask myself, what is it? Because it's always been what has pleased me most about reading fiction, the kind of movies I like to watch, and many of the works of art that I'm always changed by, is that these are works of art that have paradox and irony and upsetting expectations and turning on themselves as part of that. So I've written about this. I wrote a paper that's going to be republished soon in a version that I'm particularly happy with called The Trickster in the Arts. But that the fact that I could write that paper, and it really was one of my first Jungian papers, is coming from someone who has a certain attitude beyond himself that has worked for him. And I was, so in that regard, I found myself wondering, where did that come from? How did it come out in me? How did it help me manage my way of reading myth, using myth, understanding myth, and why am I suspicious of the other ways? And what does it mean that I am suspicious of the other ways? So those of you who know my work a bit and know that I too have contributed to complex theory and in things that I've written, but that I particularly have focused on a set of complexes that we usually talk about through another language in Jungian typology, but it's psychological types. And the theory of psychological types that Jung has given us is actually about a set of typological complexes that have the capacity for consciousness, but they also have the capacity to limit us to just seeing things through those particular lenses. So it seems to me that the most interesting thing about psychological types, as one of my many teachers that in the Jung Institute of San Francisco, but I'll name him, Dr. Joseph Wheelwright, who's many of whose papers are at Pacifica now, said once to Gregory Bateson, who was saying, I don't really like this typing, putting all these people in boxes and so forth. And Joe Wheelwright said, Gregory, that's not the real point of type. The most important thing about type is de-typing. And Gregory Bateson loved that. He said, oh, that's good. And then he went away thinking that maybe Jung's typology had something to offer in that regard. So I often wondered what that meant and what it had to do with me and my own approach to complexes and my approach to parataxic distortions, and how far have I used Jungian psychology to find my identity and my psychological type and realize its value. In my case, extroverted intuition and introverted thinking, but making me what an MBTI diagnosis would be, and even scored that way twice on the test, 1968 and 1980 when I took the test of the MBTI. ENTP, what on earth does that, what does D-typing have to do with me? And it really wasn't until I finally published my entire book on types and found that I wanted to write one more chapter that I got to the subject I'm talking about today, which is how we have to sometimes stretch our typology or stretch out of our typology to get an attitude that's adequate to the culture we live in. And in my case, if you're an extroverted intuitive man like myself and you have an inferior function of introverted sensation, well, you're going to have way down as the eighth possible of the eight function types Jung named. They're the basic units of psychological type that are like eight brilliant particles of potential consciousness. Way down on my list is extroverted sensation, and that certainly showed up in my childhood as an absolute inability to play sports of any kind. And even to this day, it can be relied upon whenever I follow my instinct as to when I'm walking somewhere, people, it's 100% accurate that if I think it's something that I'm going to is in a certain direction, it's in exactly the opposite direction. So I've gotten very used to that disorientation in my extroverted sensation. Yet I've discovered that in relating to works of art, particularly painting and motion pictures, and I move in some way beyond myself into quite a lively extroverted sensation, which is at times not undermining me, and as I call it, sometimes in a demonic way, but opening me up in what I call a daimonic way. And when I combine that with my extroverted intuition, I see things in works of art that I seem to think that, well, I believe are there, and yet something non-ordinary is happening. And at that point, I have stretched into what I would call an aesthetic attitude that makes all kinds of things possible. So when I talk about cultural attitudes, as I'm doing now, I'm talking about attitudes that enable us to not just use culture to reify our complexes, but rather to do that overcoming of the parataxic distortions into a wider view. And I found that where I can get the most use out of myth is if I relate to it aesthetically. However, I think other people do this in other ways. There are people like Dr. Edinger who would take, as Jung did, a very religious attitude toward myth, or like Dr. Hillman, who I felt takes a really philosophic attitude toward myth, and a very wonderful one in which he combines both his extraordinary introverted thinking, and he has to stretch for it, but the kind of introverted feeling that he brings together. Jung, of course, would use, and Edinger probably, if he, in the, to the degree he followed Jung, would use an introverted intuition and an introverted sensation to know something and then find a very specific sign or wonder and very definite inner fact and introverted sensation to bring together introverted intuition and introverted sensation. And when Jung and Edinger are at their best, it's really astonishing how the reality of the psyche comes forward in the most specific way, and it really makes a difference in the way we interpret dreams, whether the character goes to the right or the left, or whether they're wearing red or blue or this kind of thing. And it's shockingly specific in a very wonderfully exciting way. And finally, so many of my friends these days who are working on cultural complexes, like Dr. Thomas Singer, for example, Andrew Samuels, Samuel Kimball's. There are many, many people now working in this area of the political psyche, cultural complexes, with a social attitude, which they are combining a really caring, culturally responsible, extrovert feeling with something that doesn't seem to be like extroverted feeling. Really good, strong, extroverted thinking. So I've gradually come to feel that one of the exciting things about being an analyst in my time is to watch not just individual identities encountering archetypes, but cultural attitudes being constructed by which the archetypes can speak to us in new ways that make progress in these different areas. All of this reflects the work of Dr. Joseph Henderson. And those of you who've read his essay in Man and His Symbols that was mentioned, Ancient Myths and Modern Man, know what a formidable and an accurate user of Jungian psychology he was when that book was published in 1964. But you may not know the work that he did subsequently on the cultural unconscious as a middle ground between the personal and the collective unconscious. And even if you know about that, which led to the idea of the cultural complex developed first by Samuel Kimball's and then developed by Thomas Singer, that is now all over the Jungian world, there's still an idea that the approach is merely through refined versions of the unconscious. And they leave out the next work of Dr. Henderson, which is in a book called Cultural Attitudes in Psychological Perspective. Our field in general has yet to register the value of this book. So I'm speaking from that and saying a little bit about what I've learned about it to all of you today. So I'm going to share the screen and just show you a couple of things. And then I'm going to give you an experience of my of what I do when I am trying to see something beyond myself by using my aesthetic attitude. So What Dr. Henderson came to in this book is that all cultures all over the world at one time manifested for different people these four original cultural attitudes, none of which in the contemporary complexity of civilization wherever around the world, we see in the same pure form they once existed. But he named them the religious, the aesthetic, the social, and the philosophic. So those were the terms that he gave. And today I'm going to talk specifically about the aesthetic attitude, which turns really on the nature of beauty and the response to beauty and what we find beautiful and why we find it beautiful, and is particularly active when we engage with works of art, and how it makes what happens in life itself speak to us because of its artistry. Where what I was talking about earlier is that seen through the lens of typology, these things are constructed from personal typologies between religious, between introverted intuition and introverted sensation, aesthetic, between extroverted intuition and extroverted sensation, social, between extroverted thinking and extroverted feeling, and philosophical, between introverted thinking, introverted feeling. To make it really simple, why do I say it this way? To be a philosopher is not just to have good ideas like a brilliant introverted thinking type, it's to be equally capable of assessing the value of your ideas. To be religious is not just to have a sense that you know the divine is present, but to actually be able to see in a specific way with introverted sensation that it is. And a social attitude is not just to feel the dilemmas of other people, but to develop thinking plans to deal with them. So too, when I use my extroverted intuition to imagine things about the possibilities of a work of art, it's terribly important to me to also engage with it immediately and in the present moment. And that's what I do when I bring the aesthetic attitude to my own handling of trying to understand our culture, as I just have done in my annual film festival, where I see all the films that are likely to be up for the Golden Globes and the Academy Awards. And I try to get the cumulative understanding of where America is at this time. Quite an interesting business that's been this year, because the films turned out to be very, very good. Now let's go to the next slide. So here I am, trying to display to you my using the aesthetic attitude, which combines my native extroverted intuition, which is always seeing new possibilities, and a willingness to stop and just engage with something in front of me and for its sensual patterns. Now, what that actually is like is easiest for me to explain by showing you a film clip where there's actually an extroverted intuitive character who, by engaging with an extroverted sensation reality that in his bumbling way he's hardly able to control, manages to solve a problem for an entire group culturally. So the film I'm going to show you is the 1953 film by the French filmmaker Jacques Tati called Mr. Hulot's Holiday. And I'm going to show you two scenes from the movie, which deals with a very different time than the time we're having right now. It's summertime and it's vacation time. And these people are facing one problem that everyone I've ever known who goes on vacation faces, is to how to go on vacation and not have it become incredible bore. So that how can one have an interesting time having a vacation? And for that, in Brittany, where this where mostly English tourists are staying at a French hotel. One of the English women starts the clip by saying, "Where's Mr. Hulot?" Because she senses that only he could bring some energy into this situation that's becoming less and less interesting as the vacation time in the hotel goes on. So the film speaks for itself from that point on, and we'll just watch why Mr. Hulot is necessary, and we'll find out where Mr. Hulot has gone. And I would describe Mr. Hulot as someone who, very much like myself, in the years since I saw this film for the first time when I was 13 years old, had to make the stretch from extroverted intuition, his definitely native function, into the kind of extroverted sensation that as a filmmaker make his films so much fun, and for the sound era, as wonderful as the films of Charles Chaplin and Buster Keaton. So let's have the clip from Mr. Hulot's Holiday.
Have you seen Mr. Hulot?
Sir, Hulot? No.
Oui, je vous entends. Hein? Mais non, pas sept, 16 wagons. Oui. Non, c'est pas cher, mais non, voyons. Mais vendez, mon vieux, vendez, vendez, je vous dis. Ah, c'est pas possible, qu'est-ce que vous voulez? On attend rien.
Let's talk about what this scene, how this is constructed, how it works. It's the last night of his vacation. Mr. Hulot, a likable, bumbling, extroverted intuitive, lights a match in a dark shed. It turns out to be a storehouse for fireworks. And the pandemonium that ensues is some of the most thrillingly, exquisitely choreographed chaos one could ever hope to experience. Tati's spectacular scene is an example of what Samuel Taylor Coleridge's biographer, Richard Holmes, presents in his book, Darker Reflections, as Coleridge's mature conception of beauty. And these are words of Coleridge, or Holmes talking about Coleridge. Beauty as an explosion of energy, perfectly contained. Beauty as an explosion of energy, perfectly contained. So let's just remind ourselves of what we saw. Jacques Tati is like me. He has demonic extroverted sensation on full display. He imagines at first he'll be able to gain control over the fireworks. He attempts to extinguish them by opening a nearby hose bib, but the hose is firmly attached to the spigot and the hose's other end is coupled to a rotary sprinkler, which our hero chases in a circle as it spins. The bursting fireworks light up the sky around the hotel where other vacationers are staying and even fly in through an open window. And everyone is awakened and the energy soon ignites their enthusiasm. A Victrola is inadvertently started up and begins playing loud jazz, at which point we experience in common with the vacationers, and as you know, they weren't ready for this at first, a cultural form that actually can contain the energy Hulot has brought to their on-holiday boredom. The entire community is somehow able to join in creating a cultural attitude that is receptive to this eruption. This is the aesthetic attitude. Now, Tati cuts back to Mr. Hulot, who now carries without harm a linked pair of Catherine wheel fireworks as they twirl. They are like two sparkling centers of consciousness, but also like a bicycle, a new vehicle for him. We recognize Mr. Hulot, the persona employed by Jacques Tati, as a character who's become an artist, lit up by the possibility of being conscious of his effects. At that point, we can say that the director's aesthetic attitude has been completely constructed. one of the circles is the extroverted intuition, the other is the extroverted sensation. And indeed, as it was with this film, that Jacques Tati became recognized as a cinema auteur. Now, we have to go back to the 19th century and to one of the greatest writers about aesthetics from a poetic and philosophical point of view, Samuel Taylor Coleridge, to be able to get what it means to construct an aesthetic attitude. And he may be the greatest and the most psychological philosopher of art. And he says everything I just said to you about Tati in 1814, after he describes the effect of going to see Raphael's fresco in a palazzo in Italy, the triumph of Galatea, the same Galatea that was Pygmalion, but has a role in myth, and you can read about her in Ovid. This fresco is sometimes called the Triumph of Galatea because she has been the girlfriend of Polyphemus, who only has one eye, and he has rather imprisoned her, but she falls in love with a hot spirit named Assis, and when she and Assis are seen by Polyphemus, he immediately smashes the young man who's taken her away from him. And what she does with her powers as a water nymph is that she turns her beloved into a river, and she and he can delight together in the river. That's her triumph. Now, this is an actual fresco that Coleridge went with an American painter, Washington Alston, to see. And so the two of them go to see the painting together. And together, they discover together, and they get very excited about this, Raphael's principle of harmony, a monumental circular structure. That's what they see. And I'm going to show you the painting now. We'll share the screen and show the on the PowerPoint. They discovered watching this very alive painting, what they just thought to each other was Raphael's principle of harmony. It's a monumental circular structure within the central group, which is an old coach wheel, geometric and controlled. And this is the way Coleridge saw it, by a multiplicity of rays and chords. Now you can see the sense of rays for the arrows pointing. And if you could see better this fellow in the clouds, and you'd see what he had, he has arrows that are arranged like a painter's brush. So Raphael was having some fun with who he was as a painter, with all these lines coming in different directions. Coleridge was just knocked out by the excitement of this work of art, which you can see more closely if you happen to use the Kahn Institute online, and there's a nice discussion for about 5 minutes of just this painting, The Triumph of Galatea. But I'm interested in what Coleridge had to say, and he was noticing that there's a sort of organizing central quality. And he says, he came up with a scientific analogy, which in the period when science was just coming alive, and particularly the theory of electricity. One of his most original pieces of art criticism, Holmes tells us in this book, he praised the balance, the perfect reconciliation effected between these two conflicting principles of the free life and the containing form. So why don't we look at this slide, number five, just to see what Holmes does with this, and what they were saying. This is Coleridge. How entirely is the stiffness that would have resulted from the obvious regularity of the form, but it's fused, and if I may hazard so bold a metaphor, almost volatilized by the interpretation in electrical flashes of the free life. Think of Mr. Hulot in the fireworks when you read this passage. The chemical image was recalled from Davy's method of isolating primary elements with charges from a voltaic battery. It emphasized the dynamic, almost explosive concert that Coleridge had of beauty, or rather beauty, as an explosion of energy perfectly contained. Now, those are actually Holmes' words, but he's reading what Coleridge is trying to say. That, to me, is what it means to bring the extroverted intuition of a form in relation to the free life that extroverted sensation celebrates, like the little boy so happy when people can accept the jazz music and the whole party finally comes alive. And that aesthetic attitude for Coleridge and his friend, Washington Allston, to realize this is a principle of harmony should take you who are interested in myth into, if we could look at slide 8, take that word harmony and think about the wedding of Cadmus and Harmonia and think of who Harmonia was. Harmonia was a goddess who had quite interesting parents. One is Mars and one is Aphrodite. And at their wedding, the muses came and the graces too. And they were, the wedding of Cadmus and Harmonies has been, a whole book has been written about this as the beginning, as you know, by Colosso. But Pindar talks about this in one of his odes. And I gave it here, where there is Harmonia and Cadmus having their wedding. Harmony being present, the muses come, the graces come. And they sing the lovely verse, what is beautiful is loved, what is not beautiful is not loved. So again, harmony, the muses, the graces, Galatea and Harmonia all speak to this union of incommensurable opposites from the standpoint of our narrow type complexes, extroverted intuition, extroverted sensation, or if you like, the very different energies of Mars and Aphrodite. I've never seen a work of art I liked that didn't have dark or violent imagery of some kind somewhere in it, like the violence of the jazz music when we first encounter it in this clip. It has to mean something. It has to go beyond itself. It isn't interesting if it just keeps revolving on its own action. There seems to have to be this combination of action and form. That is where beauty, it seems to me, lies. And that's what people with the aesthetic attitude are looking for. They're looking for that to emerge. When that emerges, it seems to me, all kinds of mythic connections come to life. And so I've tried to offer you the aesthetic attitude toward myth, because of course, myth has attracted artist after artist after artist, whose job it is to capture the life that's already implicit in its own opposites. So I have just a little page of a bibliography for you to look at. So if we could just look at the references so you can see what I pulled together, so that if you want to follow it yourself, you can put these pieces together just as I did. So this is the chapter I wrote. This is the book by Joseph Henderson about the aesthetic attitude, Richard Holmes' biography of Coleridge. And I want to thank John O'Donohue. He's not alive now, but he wrote a book called Beauty, the Invisible Embrace. And it was in that book that he says so many things that he quotes briefly. And when he quoted Coleridge saying, beauty as an explosion of energy perfectly contained, I went to heaven, and I want to thank John O'Donohue for getting there first. I'll thank him again next time I come. And then finally, Ovid, who does all these things so beautifully and combines these opposites all the time in the Metamorphoses, and especially in the two myths I mentioned about Galatea and Harmonia. Thank you, Myth Salon.
I'll open it. Will, why don't we open it up to the panel and let's see who wants to go first. And
yeah, you know, I thought we might, you know, we have some people we haven't had with us before. So I thought we might honor Francis, Dr. Liu, if you have anything you want to jump in with first.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me to participate. I've enjoyed joining the Myth Salons over the past 2 years now, is it? A year and a half. And the the background, virtual background here is Esalen Institute in Big Sur, and there's the bathhouse there by the ocean. And I've led or co-led 36 film seminars here since 1987. As John was talking, I was very intrigued by the film clip that he showed, and which is not one that I've seen before in one of his presentations. I remember seeing that film a very long time ago. It really engaged me. It really caught my interest. And as he was talking about how do we understand this from the perspectives that he outlined after the film clip, it made me think of two other great comedians of the silent era. And that's, of course, Charlie Chaplin and Buster Keaton. Now, I really don't know whether their typologies fit into the schema that John is discussing. But I think in the big scheme of things, of beauty as energy contained, explosion of energy perfectly contained, I think that wonderful line captures, in my viewing of this, Chaplin and Keaton, who of course are two very important, very great silent film artists, who undoubtedly affected Jacques Tati in his work. And so I'm just trying to kind of expand on that idea, that central concept of beauty as an explosion of energy perfectly contained. And perhaps people in the audience have seen Chaplin and Keaton films where they can appreciate this this quality, this aesthetic attitude, cultural attitude that John is bringing to our attention.
You know, for years in teaching psychological types to people who are interested in really learning the different functions, I chose to use the four great silent film comedians that were named in James Agee's landmark, which I read actually as a child in Life magazine in 1949 or so, when he brought out the idea. And I felt that the beauty of the silent film comedians is that they show us introverted consciousness, which they pantomime for us using an extroverted sensation, pantomime language, so that we can actually see what the introverted functions are doing. That's been the big problem that Jung had, that introversion is often seen as an absence of extroversion or something, when actually introversion is doing something. Well, Chaplin seems to me very clearly introverted, intuitive, and Keaton a much introverted sensation. But when they're using the aesthetic attitude, they both are combining extroverted sensation and extroverted intuition. How can that happen? Well, if you look at Chaplin, it's always through the inferior function of extroverted sensation that things happen. Notably, most of all, the blind girl. Perfect image of inferior extroverted sensation. Jung had the same image in Salome. She was blind when he met him. And the blind girl as she's called girl, I mean, she's a young woman, but it's a blind young woman in City Lights, is exactly that. And it's through her that he's inspired to get the extroverted intuition that he can do something about her blindness. And this tramp succeeds in getting her operated on, and they celebrate that at the end. Whereas it's through the inferior function that he then makes the stretch and then goes beyond his usual helpless, hapless, introverted intuition that can only intuit and not do anything, and actually envisioning something he can do and realizing it, getting her the money. It's a fascinating example. And it's so aesthetically worked out and it's carried often by the music and the cinematography, everything. If you take Keaton's films, he has a dominant introverted sensation. And so he's constantly creating extroverted sensation gags where he's up against, there's one I show from The Haunted House, where he's working as a bank teller and there's a pot of glue and he's trying to handle, he's got such a good introverted sensation, he can just riffle 100 bills in his ear and tell whether how many there are. And then, but he can't, when he gets glue on his hands, handle them. And so there's this ridiculous moment where the money, it's perfectly surreal send up of capitalism. The money keeps sticking to everyone's hands, but ruining everything. It's terribly funny, but it's a perfect extroverted sensation baffle. But where it's interesting is not just that he can create these gags, but sometimes at his best with extroverted intuition, he can make them explode into a level of meaningfulness. Even in that early film, The Haunted House, it's the best film about what was wrong with the 20s and why we were definitely headed toward a crash that you could ever want. And again, it's that chaos and that mayhem, and it's absolutely delightful and that he can see, he can make that meaningful. So I think they're both constructing aesthetic attitudes out of parts of their typology. And like many artists, it's not necessarily their dominant function, or as it might be for Jacques Tati. I mean, by comparison, he's a lot closer to his conscious than I am. They're really working, as many artists tell me they do, with the unconscious, but creating something that holds together, because that attitude that we can share when we watch is pure pleasure. That's harmony. It's so good. It's just so good.
Well, I think this, I just want to comment, I think this whole thing is an interesting metaphor for filmmaking itself, you know, taking, like, letting the perfectly contained beauty explode. You know, filmmaking, of course, is that opportunity, like dreams, to make psyche sensory, to translate something inner into something sensory and experience, like a dream, like a film. And so this scene, the essence of what's making the scene so beautiful, I'm just hearing so much of what makes film work so well in the first place.
Thank you.
John, may I thank you.
Dennis.
Thank you for this. It was, this is an area that I want to know more about, and you've gotten me more excited about pursuing the typology. Here's what came up for me with this phrase that has become a motif now for your talk, that beauty is an explosion of energy perfectly contained, reminded me of Wordsworth's definition of poetry as an outer, let me get it right, a spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings recollected in moments of tranquility. That feels like the Coleridge idea. And I wonder, John, if a poetic attitude might be a synonym for an aesthetic attitude, or perhaps even a mythopoetic attitude as an aesthetic attitude. I wonder what you think about that.
I'm so glad you mentioned Wordsworth, because I suppose many of you know, but maybe not everyone in the room that's here knows, English poetry, and T.S. Eliot used to complain about this even later, much later, sort of stalled after Milton, because Milton was so powerful in the middle of the 17th century, that for about a century, that English poetry just sort of stalled. I mean, it was, or would have stalled, or half a century anyway. But in 1799, this book, Lyrical Ballads, was published, and it was Coleridge and Wordsworth creating a new aesthetic and a new way of poetry that's still absolutely wonderful. Of course, I'm leaving out Keats, who was already showing us so many things that are just perfectly sublime, and he had plenty to do with energy, perfectly contained, yes. And many of his, certainly all of his my favorite, though, to autumn is to all the feelings about autumn are perfectly contained in the form of that poem. But they were doing something new.
Yes.
But then they had a real falling out. And by 1814, when Coleridge is seeing this work, in a sense, that recollected in tranquility is what he's taking aim at. Because in many ways, Wordsworth was at least as much a philosopher as he was a poet. And I don't think Coleridge would have felt, and I don't either, that Wordsworth was truly using the aesthetic attitude. What I think he was using was the philosophic attitude. And the ode to immortality and all the rest worked perfectly. But later on, when he imagined that he was a poet, as often happens, it was a little bit flat later on because he wasn't as capable of being, the one thing he wasn't is exciting. And initially it was exciting that he could be so simple. We have someone like him in our own 20th century, W.H. Auden. There's something similar there to what happened there. And I think that, and they often begin, the thinking is so wonderful and the ability to think and feel at the same time is so exciting. But the thing that's specifically aesthetic, but does that mean that Wordsworth is no poet? No, you don't have to. The aesthetic attitude, I mean, there are painters who are philosophers. There are painters who are doing social, great social. You can have, an artist can have more than, can have, you can be in any field, you can use one of the attitudes. So it isn't like, because he isn't using an aesthetic attitude, Wordsworth isn't as good as Coleridge. Coleridge may have thought so, but I don't think so. They're just completely wonderfully, but very different. They're like a little bit like Freud and Jung. How did they, after a while, you wonder how they even got to, how did they even get to become friends? It was easier to see why they would polarize. They had to polarize. But at a certain moment, Freud and Jung came together to put depth psychology across, particularly in America. And at a certain point, these two men put poetry across for England and a whole new generation of poets, but they're using different cultural attitudes.
Yes.
And they didn't know it. And they were fighting like hell, just as Freud and Jung did. People who have different cultural attitudes fight all the time.
Yeah. Thank you, John, very much.
John, thank you for this introducing me, reminding me of Mr. Hulot's Holiday, an all-time favorite movie. It's one of the funniest movies I've ever seen. And
that's the explosion where you start to laugh.
and it strikes me that here we are. I was reading the write-up for this program and wondering if you would be talking about these vast patterns that we are barely able to grasp that are going on in the world. And instead, in some kind of perhaps compensatory way, you reminded us of humor and beauty.
Thank you.
And I think that it was just the just what was prescribed for me, certainly, at this time, to be reminded of humor and beauty. So thank you so much.
Oh, well, yes, that's the least I can do, because I don't know how to do it at a more, at a much more serious level, any more than anyone else does. Yeah.
These are not ordinary times, not normal
times. Something like that. Yeah. Thank you. That's perfect, Dyane.
John, is there any part of these movies, like Hulot's Holiday and some of the attempts at humor, that make the presentations, and I'll use the word elitist, because these situations always affect the marginalized, the people who, you know, like, for example, the waiter in the restaurant, I mean, or the owner of the restaurant that they were in. I mean, it was all of the drama exists as if they can afford to be casual. They can afford to blow the place up. and we're kind of watching them do this, but there's some part of it that I'm kind of thinking, you know, doesn't anybody have a check on them? Doesn't anybody, isn't anybody concerned about, and maybe I'm just being stiff and old and, you know, looking at it as the parent in the room. But it strikes me that some of these movies that we watched at that point were, they had a kind of a real freedom of movement that not everybody has. And maybe you would talk, I don't know whether you agree with that, but I would enjoy a reaction to that.
Well, I think that Jacques Tati is a genuinely great artist. And in that sense, he doesn't suffer from the parataxic distortion that art is all that matters, and therefore art for art's sake, and no matter, it doesn't really matter what happens outside of that sphere, because, you know, the movie was out just 7 or 8 years after D-Day. So all those things going into the building and the sense of people together anxiously waiting for something to happen still carried with it also the time of fear, the time of great uncertainty and terror. And you do get the feeling that there's a question whether maybe the guests are not necessarily going to have a good time, but can this cafe owner even stay in business is there too. And so you never lose the sense, even the music, you know, as the music of World War II, which is when jazz really took off in the popular area. I mean, of course, it had been an art form before that and for quite a while, but it really took off in the 40s in the midst of it. So you get the feeling that even though the only issue is boredom, there's also a part there's something more threatening in the horizon of this movie. The horizon of this movie is that there's a certain sphere of danger, a culture at risk. So when choosing this movie at this time, I'm also saying that we are also afraid of the explosion. And of course, explosion, art changed after Hiroshima. And so this is also a postmodern artist. Tati is not, it isn't just fun to push to the edge. So the question is, can it be held? And then when Mr. Hulot is able to hold those fireworks and the containment is secure, it's very reassuring, but it's also, where is Mr. Hulot? You have to have quite a giant sense of humor sometimes to live in dark times. So there is that, there's still the echo of that, even though this is a post-World War II movie, it's got a post-World War II conscience in it too. And that's present makes it work. I have a great deal of dislike of comedy that thinks it's funny just to push things to the every possible limit without any understanding of the pain. And so I think that's somewhere hidden in this film, but it's there. So if it weren't there, I would say that there's something big missing. I don't feel it's missing here, but I do see it missing in some things that are supposed to be funnier than they turn out to be when we see them.
So you think this movie really had some kind of underlying relevance to the times in which it was produced?
Yes.
There's a movie out now, Don't Look Up.
Yeah.
Have you seen that movie?
I have seen it. I guess we're all going to split on this movie. I mean, I guess it's, I think the movie imagines it's the Dr. Strangelove of our time. I couldn't feel the explosion of energy. I somehow it just didn't lift me. But that's just my personal. I may change my mind. I know Mick LaSalle and the critic of the San Francisco Chronicle thinks very highly of it. But I don't think I follow him on this one, as I don't always on things. Sometimes I do, and sometimes I don't. I felt that what it didn't finally deal with was the depression. There's something genuinely depressed about the movie, and I don't know that it contains its depression, because it didn't take me up. It kind of brought me down a little bit. That's just my reaction to that film. I'm not saying my feeling is the feeling, but I'm missing something.
You know, the other thing that deadens the feeling of that movie is, I think what Tolkien would say is, when the allegory is sniffed out, once you sniff out the allegory, you see the whole thing, you get the whole thing, all the energy is popped in that moment. And if you sniff out the allegory in the first 5 minutes, like anybody would in that movie, then you can pat yourself on the back for an hour and a half for getting it. But the actual charge has been depotentiated by the transparency of the one-dimensional allegory, in my opinion. Clever as it is, it's still a one-dimensional allegory.
Yeah.
Which makes a great statement. Great statement is one-dimensional allegory. Great deconstructions. I just think that, you know, as depth psychologists, as mythologists, we should demand stuff to be a little bit more symbolic, and we should hold things to standards where they, you know, when somebody's proud of an allegory, we should say, give us the symbol. You know, how smart do you feel to be able to do one layer of removed meaning? How about 3 million, please? That's what I want to see.
Well, we mustn't spoil the film, but I will say, in one way, the Meryl Streep character ruins the film. And it's almost like her introverted thinking just is too clever by half, and it, as an actress and as a character. So it sort of ruins the film until the very end when something happens. And that thing that happens is so good, given that that ruination has been so present. But I will leave it to others. There is a late shock that's very interesting, but the voltaic energy comes awfully late for my taste. That's all.
Dana began this by talking about belonging and otherness. And I like how what you've done here and in your book, if you don't mind me bringing that to bear here, how you connected typology to a generalized culture, right? And I think that's pretty fearless on your part. So I want to take that if it's okay.
Please.
And make a reference to your book, because your book was part of the description. Is that okay with you?
It's fine with me.
Okay, great. So when Dana brought up Powell, he talked about belonging and otherness, and talked about his grace, and rightfully so, and his intellect, and rightfully so. What I want to talk about, and what your book deals with, is his danger, the dangerousness of him, mm-hmm. right? And the reason why he is dangerous is because when he talks about belonging, it is not in the kind of Hallmark card way. Just as when you talk about on the Rodney King verdict, you talk about it in a very, very gritty way. So the kind of belongingness to which Powell is referring, in my mind, is a radical belongingness.
Yes.
An emergence of a new archetype.
Yes.
The archetype that I would call, that the Jung calls, the rhizome.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right? Because in Memories and Dreams, he talks about when nothing else matters, what remains is the rhizome, which is life, or what you referred to earlier as free life.
Right, Right.
So to stay with the danger trope, I want to talk about the scene you showed in relationship to jazz.
Oh, yes.
Right? Because in many ways, the jazz can be seen, and I want to take up your notion of beauty, which I love, the explosion of energy perfectly contained. But jazz actually argues something else about beauty.
Yes.
The explosion of energy that is never perfectly contained. Right. So if we think about Picasso's Cubist era,
yes.
If we think about Augusta Savage, their creativity moves us precisely because it's not perfectly contained.
Yes.
So in that scene, I see that as a kind of denial of otherness, right? Mm-hmm. In terms of the rhizomatic energy of jazz. So here's a chance to embrace otherness, but it is denied under the guise of whatever. So how then do you link that to either a typology, or as in your book, you argue that whiteness is around extroverted feeling, and race, which could be blackness, Asianness, or other, is about introverted feeling, and that race acts as if it's what I would call the unconscious. Jazz is percolated up to the surface, to the conscious, right? It's what Marianne Woodman refers to as the dark, the feminine. And for her, the feminine is always dark because of its creative potential. So then, can we talk about jazz in the way that it resists a particular kind of notion of beauty, and how it opens up to a radical belonging that indeed requires both harmony and dissonance? And what kind of typology is best suited for that? Does that make sense?
It all makes sense. And I think we're really closer than you may think. First of all, the only thing for me that perfectly contains anything are the attitudes. It's not the ego. So when I'm talking about a cultural attitude, it's that Mr. Hulot could hold those fireworks in the way that he did, those two Catherine wheels, meant that he could just manage. But this is where comedy is better than Coleridge, because it had already been established that there was no way of perfectly containing an exploding fireworks shed. And that, so it isn't, the perfectly sounds very English, and jazz is very American. What I felt at the beginning, they absolutely refused the jazz as just intrusion. And that, if you want to let that be the phantomatic presence of the black man and the black music and the black woman, and that being, this is unwelcome at our hotel. But later, when Mr. Hulot has struggled with and stretched himself to include, they too can accept the jazz and actually join it and welcome it and use it. And it solves some of their problem. It doesn't solve all of our problem. There's plenty of work left to be done. But I feel like we're watching a shift in attitude where there's the possibility of welcome. And I feel that's something very, very interesting about that. And I think you're absolutely right that there's a narrative, a phantomatic narrative embedded in the jazz music. Absolutely. And, you know, this isn't only black and white. I mean, a phantom narrative comes back in Beloved too, that has to be incorporated. And it's pretty hard to let phantom narratives in. They're painful and they're not in control. They're out of control at some level, but somehow the welcoming attitude of the group at the end excites me as a potential. But again, it's only a potential. It's not a realization, but it's a potential. At least that's what I mean. Think of the cultural attitude lets us hold, but we're talking about descendants here. The harmonia comes from Mars and Venus. They had a very unhappy marriage. So it's pretty the opposites stay opposites, but there is a welcoming potential. That's what I'm looking at.
You know, I'm thinking about Neoplatonism. We talked a lot about beauty and love and good. So it's kind of like behind this conversation in some ways. Well, in Neoplatonism, one of the most important things is to recognize that everything that is possible is good, because anything that exists is good. And so what you're looking at, something that might look to you as less than good is still within the possible. And so recognizing something that doesn't look beautiful but exists is championing its beauty for existing. And so in some ways, what I'm hearing with jazz overflowing beyond the obvious of what's beautiful, in some ways it's championing the possible. We are in love with its dissonance because it's real and it's existent and it's present in the moment. So I don't know, I wonder if that, you know, is reconciling in any way for you, Vorris.
Both yes and no. I agree with your analysis around Neoplatonism, and there's a certain kind of Taoism that would read it in the same way. See, what I find interesting is that I actually did not disagree at all with John. It was an elaboration. And going back to Dana, see, I was not talking about race only. When Dana mentioned otherness.
Otherness of any kind.
That is larger than just race.
Oh, yes.
And actually, as Kenneth Burke would argue, it is not class that is fundamental to being human. It is classification.
Yeah.
And it's through classification that we have to watch out for otherness. But otherness is central to what it is to be human. So when I went back to the jazz reference, I was not just talking about race. I was actually thinking of, as in your book, John, this shadow and how jazz embodies this shadow that we have to integrate that went unintegrated, at least then.
Well, there were, another way to look at it is, these are English people in a French hotel in Brittany, but the jazz is American. And so the third thing is America. And it's actually, who knew that America could befriend Tati? And yet Tati had taken plenty from America, as Francis Liu said. So that's in there too. They can't make it without America. They can't come together without America. So that's an interesting. The otherness is knocking at the door throughout the movie, and that may be why I think it is worth attending to, because it doesn't create a smug containing perfection, but the perfection is actually an imperfection as well as a perfection. Carol, we've been missing your voice.
I've been waiting for the time that really fit. First of all, I loved everything you said, and it was enormously helpful. And I just started out with, we're not living in normal times, or these are not normal times. And then, I'm obsessed about what's happening in the United States and thinking about it a lot, as you might imagine. And I will say also that I'm an introverted feeler with extroverted thinking.
Oh, my.
So when I get very upset about something, I have to understand it.
Yes, yes, yes.
So we're really helpful to me in that. And I've been thinking about it, but thinking about we're not in normal times, I mean, as everyone knows, we were already in a time of incredible transition. And the pace of life and interdependence and otherness. I mean, people have started saying, wait a minute, we don't like the old patriarchal, racist model. I'm here too. That's other. And now we have this pandemic and we have a culture war in my country, our country. And it struck me that we have chaos.
Chaos.
Things are very much breaking down, as you were talking about. So there is that energy. And then you kept You know, and then you started talking about the myth, and I'm thinking, well, let's see. On the right, we have Mars, and on the left, we have Aphrodite. I mean, that's what the culture war is about, only they're not married. But romance novels almost always start with a couple fighting, which gives me some hope. And then I thought, is the pandemic? Nature has its own aesthetics.
Yes, it does.
And is the container we're in this pandemic? You know, because a lot of us are in semi-lockdown all the time.
Yeah.
And forced to be thinking about what's going on. We're all thinking on this call, on this Zoom call. And, but it was funny too, because you were focusing on comedy. And I was thinking about, I've been thinking about what stories could bring us together. And I came up with a classic one that I think would be the conscious thing. But the unconscious thing, well, first of all, we're in this complex. You know, I think if there's not a steady container, the complex provides that container, and it's a warrior container. And Americans, I don't think, are naturally warrior people, but the trauma, our trauma was the Revolutionary War and then the Civil War. And so that could get quite a powerful complex going on the unconscious, and now it's here. And so what I thought was, I kept thinking, Americans actually like to laugh.
Yes.
And what the biggest influence we have in other countries is not military. We're really, you know, the Second World War, yes, but since then, we're really not very good at that. But Hollywood, you know, music, fashion, we change the world. And we also, and it has struck me that it's the fool gesture archetypal energy that you're really constellating in terms of what you've been talking about, which is very native to our country. And in fact, it's what a lot of other countries don't like about us. I don't know what else to say about that. And I want to know how you respond to that. And because what we really need is an aesthetic container. And it has occurred to me that movies are part of the answer to that. And you've been watching all the major movies in your marriage. What are you seeing?
Well, I've gotten very interested in, because I was actually asked to give a talk on it in Los Angeles several years ago, what is the child like in the 21st century? And I want to emphasize the child in this film, and the child who's turned off and then turned on, mm-hmm. and the child who's unhappy and the child who's happy in this. And of course, I've been going to movies since I was a very small boy. And so the 21st century child, two movies, right? Moonlight and Boyhood are perfect. You could add in a movie, What Maisie Knew, about a six-year-old girl based on the Henry James novel, but transplanted to New York. These are phenomenal 21st century women. And then movie that just came out called Come On, Come On, which is a wonderful movie by this Mike Mills, really gets our child today. And the 21st century child is very, very extroverted sensation and very able to take the moment and make the moment count. And come on and meet the moment and wants others to meet the moment. That could, if added to the American extroverted intuition, to which I am certainly a co-addict of, oh, come on, it's going to get better. The come on, it's going to get better is not going to happen unless it also joins, and we have to do something now in this moment. So politically, just the politics is tragic and funny at the same time. But I'm excited that Biden just yesterday said, you know, I will go for ending the filibuster if it means defending voting rights. In other words, let's stop. Mr. Smith is going to go to Washington and we're going to get it someday right. Let's try to get it right now, whatever it takes. And of course, that's the shadow side of that would be all kinds of things that I don't approve of. But filibusters can be ended without destroying democracy. A lot of other things, but destroying democracy can't be ended if we allow the filibuster to continue. So in some way, stop talking about what's going to happen and start doing something that can happen, that makes a difference. Isn't that what the child is trying to say when they say to, I mean, one child of someone in my practice said to his mother, you know, Mom, we have problems. And he meant his generation. They're going to face things that I didn't have to face, that you didn't have to face. And I thought I faced a lot in my lifetime, and I have, but some of it wasn't easy. But I don't know what's going to happen to the water supply, and I don't know whether people will have homes and a lot of other things. And so I do think, ironically, we've let the cynics have the extroverted sensation function, and we should give it to the child. And that's what I think the movies are showing us suddenly. And there's some great, see, Come On, Come On, or see 21st Century Women, or Moonlight, or What Maisie Knew, or all of the above, Boyhood. All of those are about being here now. Mm-hmm. With,
you know,
not ruining extroverted intuition to do so.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That's aesthetic to me.
Yeah,
it's so interesting. Oh, I'm sorry.
It's beautiful. Okay, it's beautiful. And that's what I mean. That's beauty for me.
That's beauty. Yeah.
Well, I'm just so struck by what you guys were saying in the first place, this whole thing around we don't live in normal times. And then when you're talking about the, I think I'm going to say the word wrong, parataxic yeah, lensing. But what I was starting to get is that the complex is the normality that you normalize around the delusion of the complex. And so there's what the statement, we're not in normal times, actually has this totally other meaning than what I first heard. At first I heard like, oh, we're in crazy times. But what I'm really hearing is we're outside the complex. Mm-hmm. We're outside of the normality that we've been inside of. And when you say, you know, you're calling for the child, well, when we look at Nietzsche's, you know, three metamorphoses, when do you call for the child? That's the third step. That's after you've left normality, after you've deconstructed normality, and when you're finally ready for something to be seen fresh and new. So I hope you're right. I hope that we are where that might suggest we are. Somewhere ready to see something new, somewhere after the deconstruction of an old normality.
That's great. Hopeful.
this is Francis. I'd just like to make a comment in the chat. Stephen Witte wrote in the chat that perhaps hexagram 30 in Wilhelm's I Ching captures the notion of contained fire.
Yes, yes, indeed. And the Parsi religion does that. Yes, 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 yes. That is the Tao chapter. I was in China talking about the I Ching in a panel of all Chinese I Ching experts. And I was pleased to say that they consider 30 the heart of the I Ching, because I do too. That's the one where the Tao, and when it's really in Tao, there's the fire and it's somehow held.
Yes, and I've pasted in the chat the beginning of Wilhelm's description of the clinging fire. And that's incredible, John, if you say that the Chinese consider that the heart of the I Ching.
Yeah, because the Tao is not really just peace. It's not just peace. And it's something else. But it's also not just Shiva either. It's not just Shiva. which is not just, I don't dare say not just she, but who am I to speak of these thoughts that way? But I mean that we need, around 2014, when it seemed like all we had to worry about was the Hopi prophecy, I discovered that in dreams, the two great figures were Shiva and Athena. And it's such an interesting thing that they were both coming up at the same time. And what I'm moving in this is something a little less serious than either of them, a little more humorous, hopefully a little more beautiful, but these opposites of fire and containment. The fire doesn't go out because of the container, and the container does not, you know, so the container enables the fire. That's something it's got to. Biden yesterday was like that, as he should be, I think, and that was nice to hear. That kind of leadership is interesting. The flat, quiet voice is not interesting. It has to have some fire, and I mean, his voice is catching fire. That will help us.
John and Will, maybe you can help me with this. When you talk about the complex and the fresh energy of something new, how does that, our typology, help me understand what happened on January 6th of last year?
Well, how does it help anyone? I mean, do I have recipes for everything? Worst of all, Hillman once said, we've had 100 years of psychotherapy and the world isn't getting any better. What I would say is we've had 100 years of the complex, and finding the archetype at the heart of the complex hasn't made us any better, Dr. Hillman. And so what I would say is the move from complex to complexity, something that Joseph Cambray at Pacifica knows a great deal about, is exactly right, because every complex is one of many, and it's a group of complexes, and they each are like electrons. They either spin up or they spin down, and the cloud can go in a certain direction, but it doesn't stop how the individual electron spins. So I'm interested in that wonderful man, the African-American policeman, as a matter of fact. I hate to keep bringing up race, it isn't necessary, but it happened to be true on that day, who used Africa's trickster just exactly right and told them to go up that way, and made it look like he was protecting people upstairs so that the people downstairs could get to the place where they would be safe from the crowd. That's what, of all the things from that day, that moved me the most. Everything else was absolutely horrible, but there was such beauty in that. And it was pivotal that day. We all know that watching that and seeing that meant a great deal to me. That crowd is really ugly, and that is not an explosion that was perfectly contained. And that kind of extroverted sensation is still, it has been underreacted to still, despite all the voices talking about it. And it could still have us, and we know it. I mean, these are horribly dangerous times, and we're on the very hinge of history. But something in the works of art I'm watching, when they work, give me some place where something lifts.
How would jazz really, what would it mean for jazz to save us? I mean, something like jazz, being in a jazz mode.
Well, you know, I listened to it all the time. I was, you know, I got these wonderful records that was a 12 record set of music from the 20s and 30s of all kinds that had somehow started new things. And they're from the original soundtrack for the film Hallelujah, which is all black film directed by a white director, King Vidor, was Nina Mae McKinney singing, I can't remember the words, but it was something like, if you're gonna move me, you're gonna have to give me more than that. And that was recorded in 1929. And she was so alive. She was so beautiful, and her voice was absolutely alive. And the thing that she produced, they cut the number from the film, but I just felt like she was doing her magic for me now. that was, and I, she was, that was cut 10 years before I was born. And so that's 92 years ago. And I just have to say that it's still that the Harlem Renaissance, for example, it just still, and Ethel Waters and Nina Mae McKinney. And I mean, even before Billie Holiday, I mean, it just absolutely incredible. So yes, it has that potential. It has that potential. Now, it has that potential. So its beauty is durable. Some things are just pretty, but because the beauty of that is durable. So that's for me where my aesthetic attitude, and listening to jazz has taught me how to appreciate film, actually, if that makes any sense.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful, wonderful. John, we're getting to the very end of our time. I want Will to make a brief announcement about next month, speaking of cosmos and the psyche, that we are doing a pulling focus next month, which those of you who have been around for a while know that our film series with the Myth Salon is called Pulling Focus. So Will, why don't you say a few words? I know Francis has to go.
Gonna miss this, Francis. Well, hopefully you'll join us for that. I think this might be right up your alley. First thing I want to say to Boris's question, actually, I think that we are going to continue answering that question next time at Pulling Focus event. So kind of a perfect question to end on. And I also want to point towards one of our good friends, Alexander Philippe, who directed Memory, Origins of Alien, and a number of other films. But Alexander just did a film called The Taking that features our friend Glenn Slater and John Booker. I make a couple appearances in it. And it's all about the John Ford movies, Monuments Valley, and the establishment of the Western West. And I don't want to give anything away, but it arcs from the establishment of the Western West into the questions that Boris is asking. You know, what happened that day, and how did we get to that day, and why did we get to that day, and what is our mythos, our cultural mythos of Western righteousness have to do with getting us there? It's a pretty cool film. It's doing great in the festivals, and we'll look for a chance to bring it to us if we can. And that conversation, what it really gets into is, you know, how did we get to January 6th? What was going on? Is there something new being born, or does that look like something old dying, resistances? I'm not sure, but I think that Dr. Tarnas is a great person to carry us further into that conversation. His book, Passion of the Western Mind, I teach for my philosophy class. It's our textbook that we're doing it right now. And the climax of that book is to look at the long arc of Western rising consciousness reaching its own passion, its own self-deconstruction. And I think that may be what we're looking at, and maybe what we're experiencing right now, and maybe we can shine some real light on it. And we'll be talking about this documentary series, and each one of the episodes explores elements of the revolution we're experiencing now, whether it's racial, gender, sexual, you name it. And it's going to be awesome. This is a pre-premiere event. This is going to be premiering about a week afterwards, after we get to show the first episode to everybody. Dr. Tarnas and the director, Kenny, are going to be there. It's going to be, and also Becca Tarnas and Saffron Rossi. It's going to be a really special, awesome event around this film. And we'll go deeper into that question. We'll keep engaging myth and film in general. And also this great question Boris has left us with today.
Wonderful, everyone. Thank you. Thank you all for attending. It is so great to see you again, Boris, you know, and Dennis, Carol, Dyane, Francis, nice to meet you. And John, thank you so much for, you know, spending the evening with us. I am going to send us out with a moment of silence. Please, thank you. And I'm so glad tonight to have invoked John Powell. It was an appropriate opening and an appropriate closing, and would love to have him on here. So thank you, everyone. These myth salons, the feedback that we get, they tell us these are like an oasis in the middle of a jungle or a desert, wherever we happen to be. It just seems to be, these are unusual, difficult times. And I'm honored to be here with our panel, my good friend, Will Linn. It's wonderful to see everybody. So on that note, good night, everyone.
Stay safe, everybody.
Good night. Thank you all.
Hey, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Renewing.
Thanks again, care. John.
Thank you all. Thank you. Thank you so much, Boris. Thanks, good to be with you. Take care, everyone.
Okay. Dana.
Anne and Carol. And Will, so great to be with you.
Yeah, thanks. I hope this won't be the last time.
Thank you.
Thank you, John.